By now, most of us have a sense of how many modern AI systems work, in particular generative AI. You get a bunch of data you want to derive predictions from, you clean it, and you make a model from it. But are the results intelligence? Can we say the model is thinking? Even though the results we get from those models can be useful, I don't think that means there's real intelligence at work. To my mind, when and if we do get something like true artificial intelligence, I'm not inclined to believe this statistical model approach is going to get us there. And to explain why, I'm going to turn to two sources of insight about both human and artificial intelligence. In 1964, a former schoolteacher named John Holt published a book titled How Children Fail. Its main purpose was to explain why he felt modern educational techniques weren't good. But it also touched on what he believed real intelligence was and how it manifested, both in children and in adults. And he wrote, "When we talk about intelligence, we do not mean the ability to get a good score on a certain kind of test, or even the ability to do well in school. These are at best only indicators of something larger, deeper, and far more important. By intelligence, we mean a style of life, a way of behaving in various situations, and particularly in new, strange, and perplexing situations. The true test of intelligence is not how much we know how to do, but how we behave when we don't know what to do." I first read those words many years ago, and I've come back to them recently with fresh eyes because they sum up nicely the key weaknesses of so many of the things we call artificial intelligence. They're failure modes. They know what to do until they don't know what to do, at which point they break completely. They don't really know how to fix their own mistakes or even recognize them. And I suspect attempts to put a band-aid on the problem, like having one AI teach another or successive models that are generated from user feedback, are only going to kick the can further down the road. There was also another sentence that Holt wrote that seems even more relevant and powerful. "Why do we talk and write about the world and our knowledge of it as if they were linear? Because that is the nature of talk. Words come out in single file, one at a time. There's no other way to talk or write. So in order to talk about it, we cut the real undivided world into little pieces and make these into strings of talk, like beads on a necklace. But we must not be fooled. These strings of talk are not what the world is like. Our learning is not real, not complete, not accurate, above all, not useful, unless we take these word strings and somehow convert them in our minds into a likeness of the world, a working mental model of the universe as we know it." Now think for a minute about how we train large language models. We're essentially taking the process Holt described and trying to perform it in reverse. We're taking the artifacts of thinking, speech and written language, and so on, and trying to reverse engineer the act of thinking from that. But I don't think we can do this. Words and speech and writing are not themselves intelligence, they're just the artifacts of intelligence. They're useful to others with intelligence, but using them to try and derive the underlying intelligence that produced them, that seems like a long shot at best. It strikes me that we've confused the products, the artifacts of thinking, with thinking itself. A generative AI model produces strings of words that are statistically likely to be responses to a given prompt. But that doesn't mean our thinking works that way. It doesn't mean thought can be modeled that way either. We can get things that superficially resemble thought or intelligence from this method, but the facade cracks pretty quickly. And it doesn't mean we can recreate the original substance of thought by amassing thought's artifacts, its end results. We're now reaching a point where the data-trained generative AI models are becoming extraordinarily big and expensive, and they still have many of the same underlying fragilities. They're not wholly useless, but they have important limits, and those limits don't seem like they can be overcome just with bigger models or more data. I think it's high time we started asking ourselves, what else could AI look like, apart from this data-driven model system? And there's hints of such things bubbling up. In fact, they've been around for some time now. One of them is not to use data, not to use end products as such, but rather to build impulses into a system, to make it want to learn and understand. And that's easily an order of magnitude harder than using an LLM on trained data, but it may be the more correct route. To that end, I have another insight from a fellow named Richard S. Sutton, a computer scientist who's done much important work in the AI field. And he has an essay entitled The Bitter Lesson, in which he talks about the limits of creating AI by way of amassing data or building our understanding of the world into the model that we're using. And he writes, The actual contents of minds are tremendously, irredeemably complex. We should stop trying to find simple ways to think about the contents of minds, such as simple ways to think about space, objects, multiple agents, or symmetries. All these are part of the arbitrary, intrinsically complex, outside world. They are not what should be built in, as their complexity is endless. Instead, we should build in only the meta-methods that can find and capture this arbitrary complexity. Essential to these methods is that they can find good approximations, but the search for them should be by our methods and not by us. We want AI agents that can discover like we can, not which contain what we have discovered. Building in our discoveries only makes it harder to see how the discovering process can be done. To that end, whatever comes next is not going to be about models based on training from artifact data. It isn't going to come from, as John Holt said, cutting the real undivided world into little pieces and stringing them like beads on a necklace for our AI models. It's going to be about discovery. It's going to be about building something that figures out the world as it goes and generates intelligence from that, much as we ourselves do. Now, how that works and how feasible it is, I am as uncertain of that as you are, but I am wildly curious to see if it's possible and to see it happen. So that's it for this episode. If you liked it, leave a comment below, and don't forget to follow Dev with Serdar and InfoWorld on Facebook, YouTube, and InfoWorld.com.